Good morning. Am I on? Good morning. Okay, there I am. I'm Reverend Melissa Keim Hall, one of the pastors here at Oak Grove, and I am so glad to welcome you to worship today. We hope that you'll let us know that you're here either by signing in on the red pew pad that is right there at the end of the pew, or by going online at ogumc.org connect and signing in digitally. Also, you can go check out our website, ogumc.org, and find out about all the great things that are going on here at the church. And you can join the conversation online on Instagram and Facebook. This coming Wednesday night, on the 24th, is our last Wednesday night dinner beginning at 5 p.m. Following dinner at 6 p.m., our children's choirs will present a concert in song and through bells for us at 6 p.m., also in the fellowship hall. You don't want to miss that, so go ahead to make your reservations at ogumc.org news. And then the following Wednesday night, May 1st, is, and I don't know what I'm getting myself into with this, the second annual staff skit and meal. That begins at 5:15 with the skit beginning at 6:21. Not 6:20, not 6:22, making sure I got that right for our very precise John. On the menu is Allison's fried chicken, and then you get to watch the staff make good fun of themselves up on the stage. And all of the proceeds from that will go to Missions, Music in Mission, which is the outreach arm of our music ministry. And then today in the 10:45 service and here in the 11 o'clock service is Confirmation Sunday. Between the two services, we have 18 students being confirmed. Confirmation is a time in students' lives where they intentionally explore their faith, they grow in their relationship with God, and they can join God in the work that He is doing here in this world. Today, we are going to continue our worship series, It's Not Complicated, with a focus on We Help Each Other. Welcome to worship.
Please stand, are you able, for the call to worship found in your bulletin. Come, let us rejoice in the gift of life.
Let us sing praise to God who has made us to live.
Let us worship our Lord and celebrate.
Thank you. Y'all turn my mic on? Please turn my mic on. All right, friends, we're having a fire alarm, and so we're going to ask everyone to kindly and thoughtfully exit. If you'll exit out the back door or out the side door, please. It's okay, we're good, and we'll continue the service after the alarm is over. If I could have your attention. Thank you for being a wonderful and thoughtful congregation. The live stream is still going, so we can all go back and laugh at this. Would you join me in a word of prayer so we might recenter ourselves, and then we'll sing our opening hymn and continue this wonderful and delightful and unexpected service of worship. Let's pray. God, thank you for the many ways that we care for one another, for our first responders who help take care of us, for all of our staff and amazing folks, and for all of the things we get to laugh about later on. Bless us in this church. We thank you for keeping us all safe and making sure there was no fire and that we are all in good hands. May we continue in this service of worship, celebrating this holy and awesome occasion of confirmation for our students. We pray this prayer in the powerful name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Amen, friends. Well, now I invite you to stand as you're able as we join together in singing our opening hymn, How Can We Name a Love, hymn number 111.
God, the creator of heaven and earth, made us in God's image and likeness. Our one tone provides unconditional love, guidance, and protection. God is all-powerful, all-knowing, and always with us. God gives us peace, comfort, and a sense of purpose. We believe that Jesus is the Almighty, the only Son of God, and has an unending love for all. For our sake, he came to forgive our sins and is the embodiment of hope for all people. We believe in the Holy Spirit received at baptism. The Holy Spirit gives us gifts of comfort and the fruit of the Spirit. We believe that forgiveness is a very important part of our faith. Jesus died to forgive us of our sins. God is forgiving us all the time because God loves us. We believe that God is with us. Even if we die, we are still with God. We are not alone. Life is not the end. God is love. There is hope for the world.
As we enter our time of prayer this morning, there are a couple of things I do want to lift up. First, we have a celebration. Jasmine and Tyler Howard welcomed their son, Murray Baker, on April 9th, and so we are very excited for our newest young Methodist. Also, hold in your prayers Celine Hall, who is in the hospital, and Reese Phoenix, as well as Bull Wallace, who is back at church but still recovering from a procedure he had earlier this week. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we come before you today with praise for your great love toward us. We come with trust that you are always with us, even in the most unexpected moments. And we are grateful for your guidance in our lives, for the ways that you show us how to love and be present with one another, just as you love and are present with us. But we know, Lord, that we are not always the best listeners. We love to hear your voice, and yet at times we find it difficult to be obedient to it. Forgive us when we try to keep you as our own, when we try to do things our own way. And open our eyes so that we see how deeply you love all people, and help us to love as you love. Let us find rest in the knowledge that your goodness and grace are always with us. Lord, today we lift up names and situations of illness, loss, stress, and concern. And in each of these situations and for each of these people, Lord, we pray for restoration and for healing. We pray that they will know your love and your presence, and that comfort will fill their hearts and minds. We pray too, Lord, for our confirmands this morning and the commitment that they are choosing to make today. We pray that you will continue to draw them close to you, that they will continue to grow in their relationship with you, and that they will each day be filled with the desire to join in the work that you are already doing in this world. And as we pray for them, Lord, help us in the same way to trust you and to remember that you have called us all to be your witnesses and workers in the world. Give us strength and courage and boldness and joy and hope and peace for the work that you have prepared for us. And we pray these things, Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life for us and who again will come and live with us in the way that he taught all disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand for a reading from the Gospel. A reading from John 10, 11 through 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. I have received this command from the Father. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Friends, we invite you to remain standing as you're able as we sing together our middle hymn, Holy Spirit, Come and Confirm Us, hymn number 331.
All right, you may be seated. Happy Confirmation Sunday, everybody. It is good to be with you all. Confirmation is a time in a young person's life in which they're invited to intentionally explore how God is at work in the world around them, and hopefully it culminates in them making the decision to follow Jesus and to join God in the work that God is already doing. And this year, as we're celebrating these confirmands, their decision to join in membership with Oak Grove, and most importantly, their decision to follow Jesus, we thought we would take a second to share what this confirmation experience has been like for these confirmands in their own words.
Hi, I'm Meryl Vaughn. The most meaningful part of confirmation to me is being able to participate in this journey with others. Learning and growing in my faith while doing so in community was truly a gratifying experience. Whether that be by going to confirmation class, taking part in volunteer work, engaging in worship, or during confirmation retreat. I am also grateful for the support I received from my friend in faith, CJ, and other adults in confirmation. My friend in faith, Kathy Huffines, taught me how to dive further into scripture and find the deeper meaning within them. Through confirmation, I learned how to better love and support others through the example of Jesus.
I'm Caleb, and I'm in confirmation. The most meaningful part of confirmation for me was getting to spend time with so many people my age and getting to see them every Sunday. Also, getting to learn about God and other stories of the Bible so much more in depth was a great experience. I love getting to do this at Oak Grove, and I'm so glad that many other kids younger than me get to also have this experience at the church. It was so meaningful to me that CJ and the other youth leaders put so much into giving us the best confirmation experience, like having guests and going on the confirmation retreat. Lastly, getting to choose a friend in faith was so nice, and I love getting to go through confirmation with someone that I knew. It was so comforting.
I'm Ainsley Schaefer. The most meaningful part about confirmation was learning about my faith with my peers in a way that I understood. The retreat allowed me to feel closer to God with my fellow confirmands. This experience really helped me deepen my faith. It was really cool to see how our church connects with the world. Confirmation was especially impactful thanks to my wonderful friend in faith that guided me throughout this amazing journey.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for supporting confirmation, Oak Grove United Methodist Church.
Friends, let's hear it for our confirmation class for this year. One of the things we get to see as pastors and other people in all of this process for confirmation is to hear from them and see things that they're growing and learning and doing. Our friends in faith can absolutely affirm that. I do want to give a special shout out to our youth staff, CJ and Hannah, for their amazing work, for all of our friends in faith, for the confirmation students themselves, their family and friends who are all here. All of the work that we do together in ministry for our youth and all the way through all the generations here at Oak Grove is possible because of the ways that you give. And friends, I'd like to invite one of our confirmation students, Porter Bemis, to invite us now in our offertory prayer.
Please join me in the reciting of the offertory prayer printed in your bulletin. Everything we have has come to us from you, O God. Bless us that we may return to you a share of your own generosity. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 through 24. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. How does God's love abide in anyone who is the world's goods? Does God's and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in the truth and action. And by this, we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him. Whenever our hearts condemn us, for God is greater than our hearts and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us and we have boldness before God and we receive him from whatever we ask, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is the commandment, that we should believe in the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Be seated. Sorry I was almost late. There was a little disturbance in the building. Our lesson for today is very fitting for a day on which we receive our confirmands into the membership of the church. They've been studying the faith together all year, and today they become the newest members of our community. I say it's fitting because today's reading is all about how we as Christians are to treat the people around us, how we are to function as a body of Christ, how we are to treat those who are in this community with us. The letters of John paint a picture for us of how one of the oldest Christian communities was taught what was most important about being a Christian. And that is also what we seek to teach our confirmation class. These letters are filled with simple and direct lessons, and the lesson for today is to help each other. John writes plainly in this passage, "Little children, let us love not in word or in speech, but in deed and in truth. We know love by this, that Christ laid down his life for us. Therefore, we ought to lay down our lives for each other." But what does it mean to lay down our lives for each other? In part, it means to stand up for one another, to be present for one another, to dedicate ourselves to the service of others so that all may be surrounded by the steadfast, life-giving love of their community. When we prepare youth to join the church, we ask them all to affirm that they will participate in this faith community by their prayers, their presence, their gifts, their service, and their witness. And I always explain that participating in the church through your presence, P-R-E-S-E-N-C-E, simply means that we show up for one another. We are present. We bother to come to church. Why? Not just because coming to church builds us up and feeds our souls, but also because someone else who is coming to church on any given Sunday may long to see us, may need our support, may want to spend time in the presence of their community, and we are their community, and so we should be here for them. Every member of our confirmation class sits down with a pastor in the week or two before Confirmation Sunday, and we ask them about how the process went for them, what was their favorite part, what they'll remember the most, and whether or not they feel prepared to answer the questions that we're going to ask them in a moment. Almost all of the kids that I interviewed this year stated that their favorite thing about confirmation was being in the group with the other kids, which I think you also heard in the video segment. Seeing their friends every Sunday morning, being together in a group of others their own age, getting to know kids they would not otherwise have known. If this didn't come up as the thing that they loved the very most about confirmation, it inevitably came up through one of the other questions. Forming a community with whom to gather, being with each other, supporting each other, this is the foundation of our Christian faith. Another subject that we raise in the confirmation interview has to do with something else that John's letter addresses in today's reading. It's the subject of what to do about evil in the world. We always go over the questions that will be asked, and the first two confirmation questions bring up the subject of evil in the world. The first says, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? The second question is, do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? This language may sound antiquated, but its meaning is very simple. There are things in the world that are just not right. It's the job of the Christian to set things right. John's letter brings up the issue of poverty, a worldly evil that is as old as time. He asks, how does God's love abide in anyone who has the world's goods and sees a brother or sister in need and yet refuses to help? When we accept the freedom and power God gives us to resist evil, injustice, and oppression, that means that we don't just stand by with our arms folded when we see someone in need, when we see someone being persecuted, when we see someone who needs our help. We can't be those who avoid helping others by claiming our own weakness. Oh, I'm just one person. I can't defeat evil. I can't end poverty. Perhaps that's true, but God has given us power, and we must accept that we are to use that power to make positive change, to resist evil, injustice, and oppression. Yes, we are just individual people, but on our side is a powerful God and a loving community. There's nothing that we cannot do. To be a Christian means to see the reversal of injustice as part of our purpose in life. We don't ignore evil. We don't claim to be powerless against evil. We claim the power God has given us to bring change, to help others, to lay down our life for those whom we love, just like Christ laid down his life for us. This is what it means to be a Christian, to be here for one another, to be sensitive to the needs of those around us, to be dedicated to doing everything we can so that evil will fail and good will triumph. Christian community exists to give us strength and reassurance that we do not do this work alone. We do this work through the combined gifts and graces of everyone in the community. So I'd like to tell you a little bit about these, our newest community members, as well as those who just joined the church at the 10:45 service. If we had all day, I would call up each of their friends in faith to say more than the things they and CJ and Hannah shared with me about them. But here is just a small description of the friends who are joining Oak Grove United Methodist today. Ella Behrman is quiet, yet loyal and steadfastly devoted to her friends. Porter Bemis has a delightfully random sense of humor, as well as an endless supply of energy. Waylon Burkhart is loving and kind and someone you know you can always depend on. Caitlin Flowers is genuinely kind and a true seeker of a deeper faith. Harper Hansen has a quiet strength and a steadfast devotion to her friends. Owen Harrell is secure enough in himself that he is able to form friendships across many of the lines that keep others separated from one another. Mallory Harry is sweet and reserved, but comes alive when she's in the presence of her friends in the youth group. Thomas Heidel is that special person who is always there for his friends, reliably standing with them at all times. Thomas Hurst is a deep thinker who grows in his faith by being genuinely interested in the ideas of others. George J. is an instigator, someone who encourages others and gets them going. Wyatt Lupke is respectful and considerate and committed to being present in the life of the youth group. Charlie Palmer is an independent thinker. He is making his own way. He is writing his own faith story. Riley Sanders is a serious thinker. She wants a deeper faith and is willing to go out in search of it. Ansley Schaefer is a ray of light. She is helpful and kind and radiates joy. Caleb Schaffner is a natural leader who brings others in and makes them feel included. Sadie Thompson is sweet and serious, but she is also smart and fierce and someone you can trust. Meryl Vaughn is funny and smart and loyal and dedicated. She gets this whole church thing, and she loves being a part of it. Matthew Wagner loves to serve. He is trustworthy. He is mission-minded, and he is considerate of others. These are the newest members of our community. This is the community of our confirmation class. Not all of them will be with us here for life. Some of them will travel far away from here. Some will eventually settle down in other faith communities. But while they are here with us, they will bless all of us with their insights, their dreams, their energy, and their spirit. We are blessed to have been a part of their journey of faith, and we look forward to seeing how they will help one another along in this life of faith that we all share. To quote the words of the writer of 1 John, "This is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another." It's not more complicated than that. Believe in Jesus and love one another. Be there for each other. Help each other. I believe our confirmands have learned all of this, and we are blessed to be part of this community with them. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. At this time, we are going to turn to the confirmation liturgy, which is on the insert in your bulletin.
Through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, offered to us without price. Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church.
Now I'd ask for the confirmants to stand, please. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? If so, say, I will. Do you receive and affirm the teachings of our faith as contained in the Old and New Testaments? If so, say, I do. And now we would invite the friends in faith to come forward with their confirmands and to present them.
I present Harper Diane for confirmation.
I present Porter Jane for confirmation.
Harper Diane, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now I present Porter Jane for confirmation.
Jane.
Porter Jane, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Owen Ray for confirmation.
Owen Ray, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Thomas Hugh for confirmation.
Thomas Hugh, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Thomas Candler for confirmation.
Thomas Candler, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present George Goodwin for confirmation.
George, remember your baptism? Be thankful.
All right.
George Goodwin, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Wyatt Douglas for confirmation.
Wyatt Douglas, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Riley Elizabeth for confirmation.
Riley Elizabeth, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Ansley Joyce for confirmation.
Ansley Joyce, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Marilyn Elizabeth for confirmation.
Marilyn Elizabeth, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I present Matthew Bennett for confirmation.
Matthew Bennett, may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now I would invite the newly confirmed folks on the front row to stand again, if they would. As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say, I will. Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members, together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. That in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. May the God of all grace, who has called us into eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. Now let us applaud for them. You may be seated until I tell everybody to get back up again in about 2 seconds. We are so glad for these, our newest members in the faith, but we also will extend an invitation to any who are here and to those who are worshiping with us online today. If you are interested in becoming a member of Oak Grove United Methodist Church, if you're in the room, you can just come down at the end of this hymn and speak to Melissa or Joseph or myself about joining. Or if you're worshiping with us online, you may contact us through email and we'll be glad to answer any questions that you may have. Now let us stand either in body or in spirit and sing together the summons, which is in this little black hymnal here, number 2130. Let us sing.
Amen.
If you're wondering why we're standing here, these are some of your community members who will be going to the General Conference beginning tomorrow in Charlotte, North Carolina, along with Bishop Goodpastor. Bishop Goodpastor is already there at the Council of Bishops meeting. Yes, see, Bishop Goodpastor. He allowed us to make this flat depiction of him, provided we would take it to General Conference so he could put it in his chair and slip out. But at any rate, Allison Burke, who's a member of our church, is our conference treasurer, so she will be attending. Elizabeth is part of a seminary class that's going to be going to study what the General Conference is and what it does. Rachel and I are voting delegates, as are many other people that you know, like Dana Everhart and Phil Schrader, who have at one time been connected with our church. We were elected back in 2019 to attend a General Conference that was supposed to happen in 2020 and was postponed because of the pandemic. So this has been many years in coming, and we covet your prayers. Joseph.
Pray for them and for the General Conference. Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for this unique part of your entire church that we call the United Methodist Church. We thank you for all those who have gone before us, all who are here now, and all who will come after us. We pray for the work of this General Conference, especially those attending from our community here, for Rachel, for Beth, for Larry, for Allison, for Taylor, for Elizabeth, and for Stella Ray. We entrust your care those serving as delegates, that you might strengthen them, give them that physical strength, mental strength, and spiritual strength to conduct their work with courage, with love and resiliency. God, we prayed for a renewed commitment in our world to make disciples for the transformation of the world. Guide the delegates in each and every decision using that ideal. God, may you empower this General Conference to negotiate hard decisions wisely, and to refrain from making some decisions more challenging than they need to be. We pray for reform for the right reasons, the right areas, in this right time. God of us all, renew our United Methodist Church. Fill us with that promise and hope of resurrection and a sense of hope for the future. Grant to your church an optimism balanced with realism, strengthened by our efforts together to do your holy work, sustained by the power of your Spirit. May this General Conference work and encourage and strengthen the entire United Methodist Church on all the levels, from around the world to here in North Georgia to our very own remarkable community here at Oak Grove United Methodist Church. We pray this in the powerful name of your Son, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen.
If you are bored out of your mind and would like to watch General Conference on the live feed, go to www.umc.org and you can watch the proceedings. It's kind of like churchy C-SPAN. So now may you go forth into the world to love God and your neighbor in all that you do. And may God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit go with you. Amen.